Definitely. Thank you all again for your patience. I do have the housekeeping to get us started with. So thank you for joining us today. I am Deanna Garner, and the Recycling Market Development Program Manager for the Indiana Department of Environmental Management's Office of Program Support. All microphones should be currently muted. If you are not muted, please mute yourself. And if you're not a presenter, I will ask at this time to go ahead and turn off your cameras. We will be utilizing the chat and raise hand feature for questions and comments from participants at today's meeting. To access chat, you should have a icon at the top of your screen on the menu bar. You can click on that option and a chat dialogue should open up for you to provide your questions and comments. And we will address these at the Q&A portion of the discussion. If any members of the media have joined us, please utilize the chat feature or email media@idem.in.gov if you have any questions or if you'd like to schedule an interview. This meeting is being recorded and will be posted on IDEM's website at recycle.in.gov. With that, we will begin today's Indiana Recycling Roundtable discussion. I would like to welcome all of today's participants. I'm so glad you guys are here and able to make it, and we're able to get the new link to join us. As we continue to host more of these discussions, your feedback is valuable. We will be sharing the link to an evaluation form in the comment box. Please take the time to fill out that link. We have some additional questions we are going to be asking that I'll bring up in a little bit as well. So without more delay, I'm going to go ahead and bring up my PowerPoint and get started on a little refresher of kind of our goals, and then go start talking about organics management and recycling in Indiana.
Yeah, it just says recycling roundtable discussion.
Okay, you can see that. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, but sometimes okay. You go in and out.
Oh boy. Well, we'll give it our best. I don't know why it says I'm on hold, so I don't know. Navigate this page. Yes. And did that page switch to recycling roundtable discussion?
Yes.
Goals. So we are hoping to discuss and identify issues, brainstorm solutions, and share resources to current challenges facing recyclers in Indiana's recycling industry. So the purpose of these meetings is to facilitate solutions, help Indiana meet its goal of a 50% recycling rate, also while helping to spur the economic growth of recycling markets here in the state. As mentioned before, please take a moment at the end of this discussion to provide your feedback. A link to that evaluation form will be provided. Here is our agenda. So we are going to have an item welcome, which we just did. We're going to talk a little bit about Indiana organics infrastructure and data. Go into some collection and contamination reduction efforts, discuss some different public-private partnership opportunities around residential collection of organics and food waste, then move into additional community partnerships as well as compost site management, and moving forward through another option besides compost sites, and talk a little bit about organics management through anaerobic digestion, and hopefully. We are probably going to go a little bit over because this was already a very packed presentation. So we will try to provide a Q&A portion still and provide conclusions. Real quick, I just wanted to start off by talking about organics in Indiana. Why do we do it? In Indiana, there is a yard waste disposal ban that bans us from having certain types of materials in our landfills. So that's first and foremost. And we also have a 50% recycling goal. Now, EPA estimates that about 40% of recyclable material is considered, or not, actually, sorry, 40% of our entire municipal solid waste stream is organic material, food waste, and wood waste. So there's a huge opportunity to move the needle forward on our 50% recycling rate by adding that organics component into it. And of course, there's many other environmental benefits. I just wanted to touch base to let you know a little bit about our infrastructure here in the state. We do have 108 active registered compost sites throughout the state, which is great. That's awesome. 16 of those sites also take food waste. And as reported in 2021, those sites received 372,000 tons. Now, those numbers equate to approximately about 4% of our total municipal solid waste stream. If we add in wood waste to that equation, we're close to 9% of the municipal solid waste stream. So in Indiana, we have a 20% recycling rate. We're talking about 9% of that, or 45% of our total municipal solid waste stream is wood waste and organics. So it just highlights again that importance of being able to manage those products appropriately and divert them from landfill. So in addition to that, I did want to mention that in Indiana, we do have approximately 11 anaerobic digesters at wastewater treatment plants or confined feeding operations that also can accept food waste as well. So that is one option that is being utilized in our state. With that, I am going to stop sharing possibly and invite our first presenter from the city of South Bend, Kara, I apologize if I don't say this right, Grabowski.
Right.
And she is the marketing director with the Department of Public Works, and she is going to highlight some of her collection and contamination reduction efforts in South Bend.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm going to share my screen. Can you see my presentation?
Yes.
Okay. Created a brief one. I'll try to go through it quickly, but also thoroughly. So as Deanna mentioned, I'm Kara Grabowski. I'm the marketing director for the Department of Public Works. Bend. Our Department of Public Works is comprised of an engineering division, wastewater and wastewater division, solid waste, and then our streets, sewers, and traffic aligning division. So today I'm going to briefly talk about some of our collection contamination reduction efforts. Here we go. So in 2021, we piloted a yard waste 101 pilot. It was a campaign, an education campaign aimed at reducing yard waste and yard waste contamination found in bins. So the city was starting to see more and more yard waste as we would collect. Let me see. The city was starting to find increased amounts of household trash, food waste, plastic bags, recycling in residents' yard waste bins. And for our yard waste program, only grass clippings, leaves, twigs, and weeds were accepted. And so at that time, the city had an AmeriCorps program. It was part of our sustainability division, which was actually part of our public works department at that time. And so we used our AmeriCorps members to launch a 6-week pilot. 5 of those weeks were actually monitoring. And what we did was basically I've done a lot of research on how other municipalities have tried to reduce contamination and recycling. I'm sure several of you have probably heard of like the Oops Shine On program. I know the Phoenix, Arizona Department of Public Works did something with their recycling program, and other recycling programs across the country are doing something similar. So I talked to Phoenix, heard what they were doing, and tried to tweak it to do something for our yard waste program. So essentially, my goal was trying to curb contamination at the curb, literally stopping it at the curb. So basically, our AmeriCorps members for the first week has sort of an education campaign, but also out of safety, we distributed these door hangers, which you see a photo of on the right-hand side, to all of our customers within the pilot area. We had about 700 yard waste customers in that area. And so we distributed this on the month. Their pickup day was on a Monday. So the first week of our pilot, they went out on that Monday and distributed this to all of our yard waste customers. That way we could inform the residents that, hey, you know, starting next week, our AmeriCorps members will be, you know, going, walking your neighborhoods and monitoring bins, meaning, you know, we're going to be looking through your bins. So just so people knew that this was happening, but also we could use it as a an education opportunity to remind them of what goes in their bin and what does not go in. So again, we distribute these on Monday. Their pickup day was Monday. So therefore, they started with a brand new empty bin that day, more or less. 5 weeks after, we did actual monitoring. So our AmeriCorps members, we're equipped with, they had their AmeriCorps shirts, we had them with their vest. We also had them with, they were always in pairs. We had two groups of two that went street by street. And then they also were equipped with iPads. So on their iPads, our IT team actually created a data collector app that they could use on their iPad so that they could help track data and information as they went house by house. For example, you know, there are 700 customers in this target or this pilot area. However, what we learned was not all 700 customers put out their yard waste bin for pickup every week. Our yard waste program runs April 1st through November 30th, and it offers pickup every week on the same day of your trash bin pickup. So basically, our AmeriCorps members, they collected a variety of information. What they did was, you know, they would first collect whether or not that customer's bin was out or not for pickup that day. And then they would also check their bin. They would go through and track, open up the bin and see if they saw any visible signs of contamination. We did not give them sticks to dig around. And I know that we have heard about how some of our customers will tend to bury their contamination in the yard waste bin, and therefore you don't see it until after you dump it. But just as a pilot, all we did was just allow them to open it up and see if they saw any visible contamination. If they saw visible contamination, they would provide, they would mark this with the stickers. We designed stickers for them, as you can see on the right, and they would say, hey, you know, it's not collected today due to contamination. And then we would also have them circle what items were found in there and sort of educate them on what they would see. Now, our AmeriCorps members, they would also track that in the app. We would have them mark down what it was, whether it was recycling, whether it was food waste, trash, so that we could document that. And then also they took a photo so that we could see what those items were and what it looked like. And then therefore we knew when they went the following week, if that person put out their bin to look for, they could see that, hey, last week when this person put out their bin, it was contaminated. I'm going to look through it and see if there is still that contamination or not. So when contamination was found, they found the first violation, they received the sticker. The second violation, we had it set up to where they would get a sticker and a letter, and the letter would tell them, like, would define what we were seeing in it, but also tell them, hey, you know, next time if we spot contamination, you know, you will get a fine. So we again ran this for only 5 weeks. One thing, for example, here's a funny story that goes along with the third violation, you know, sticker, you get a sticker, you would get a fine, and then you would get a call. Our solid waste director actually called someone because for 3 weeks in a row, we kept finding Lime Away bottles in their yard waste bin. And for 3 weeks straight, it was not collected. So we gave her a courtesy call because the previous week we sent her a letter. It didn't change anything. And we gave her a courtesy call and we said, well, you know, you have Lime-Way bottles in your yard waste. It's contaminated. We cannot collect it. And she was like, oh, okay. Can you tell me like who can fix my sewer? So she didn't seem to be very concerned about it, even though we had done 3 methods of communication, 3 different rounds of, made 3 different rounds of effort with her to explain it. She was less concerned with it. So what we found was, obviously, you know, we did a 6-week pilot program. We did it in the summer. We found out that 5 weeks was far too short. One thing that we were lacking in this was data. You know, we had seen that when we would dump our yard waste at our organic resources facility, we would see trash, we would see contamination. However, we don't have necessarily the data to determine what is the percentage of households are contaminating every week. So that is kind of why we took this small snippet of 700 customers to see if we could dive into that a little bit more and get some data. Another thing that we discovered is, even though it is a weekly yard waste service, not everyone puts out their bin every week. So we would go 1 week where a customer would put it out and then they wouldn't put it out for 3 more weeks. So sometimes while we would see contamination the first week, they wouldn't put out their bin again during the rest of the pilot. So therefore we didn't know if they removed the contamination or what. And then something else that I found rather interesting was that we would see the same number of contaminated bins each week. We would see roughly, if we would find contamination in roughly 10 to 12 bins. However, it wasn't the same 10 to 12 individuals that it was the previous week. Occasionally it was one or two from the previous week that just carried it over, but then we would find, you know, 10 other individuals that had contamination. And then the people who we had saw contamination in the previous week never even put out their bin that week. So we couldn't see. What we needed was probably a lot farther, longer pilot period to get better data and determine people's behaviors. And you can see kind of what our AmeriCorps members did. They just looked at the top, saw if they saw contamination and put it in their data collector app. So there are first couple things, you know, after we went through this pilot in 2021, there are a couple things that we changed and try to do with education. I'm sure several of you on this call probably fall into the same area as we did. You know, this is a program that launched probably 15, 20 years ago, and most municipalities are guilty of, well, we communicated at the very beginning of the program, and that was it. Those were only resources we had. We don't have time to devote someone to constantly educate. And that's kind of what I found here, is that we would send out our press release at the beginning of yard waste season in April announcing it, and then that would be it. We would not do anything until the following year when we re-announced it. So a couple things that we looked at to make changes along the way is that when we looked at the side of our bins, you can see on the left, that was an old sign. I'm sure several of you have this. If you have any sort of bins, trash bins or anything, the design changes and you have varying iterations of designs on bins. And so I think probably our yard waste bins have 2 or 3 different variations out there from people who designed them prior to me. And the problem is we aren't able to go and exchange everyone's bins for the new bins. So moving forward, we wanted to make it very well known that this was yard waste. So on our old design on our bin, you see that we have the city of South Bend, the seal, the city skyline, and then at the very bottom, the yard waste program. And then you can kind of see on the right hand side, on the top of the lid, all we said was yard waste only. So one thing we did in the past year was we actually redesigned the outside of the bin so that customers, as they sign up, again, this is an opt-in program, so it's not like trash where everyone gets a bin. This is an opt-in program. We have about 20,000 yard waste customers right now. And so, but as people, you know, at opt-in to the program, we do give out new bins as bins get stolen or they get broken or whatnot. We do swap out bins. So we try to make it very easy to know that, hey, when you're seeing this, this is yard waste. And then we revamped the top of the lid so that we could use it as an education component and really show what can and cannot go in there. And we're trying to use more illustrations as well as in addition to words so that some we know that people obviously learn visually in different ways. So we wanted to make sure that we showed examples of what can and cannot go in there. And then also, these are old stickers that we did. You know, our solid waste team would just come up with their stickers. They didn't have any branding. Some of them were very basic and didn't actually explain anything. So we revamped our stickers. As you can see, I broke this up into two parts because it's really one big sticker, but in order to get it on the slide. And so we use our solid waste drivers actually use this for both trash and yard waste. So one thing that actually came out of the pilot was there was confusion about our contamination fees. Our ordinance at the time just said, you know, your third offense, you would get charged a fee. However, there wasn't any time to that, you know, and so does that mean your third offense in 5 years? Does that mean your third offense in 2 months? Does that mean, you know, your third offense in the calendar year? So we did update the ordinance to reflect that it was per calendar year, so it was clear. And then also you can see, you know, we have reasons why bins were not collected. You know, sometimes they're blocked by vehicles. The lid wasn't completely closed. You know, their bin is out, but their account is inactive. And then here again, we kind of match the logo of the bin that we use the graphic to what the actual bin looks like. And then went again with the illustrations and list everything of what cannot be in the bin. And then also, we recently went through items recycling grant program. We were given a grant last calendar year, and we worked with them to do some education campaigns. And one thing that came from them is we actually were able to do two mailings to our yard waste customers. So we had done one in the summer, reminding them of what goes in and does not go in their yard waste bins. And then also at the beginning of this year's yard waste season, in the middle of March, we were able to send out this postcard to everyone, just reminding them that, you know, yard waste begins the week of April 3rd, and then what does go in and does not go in the bin. So we also had created a video to explain that too. And so this was also just part of some of our education components that we are doing to help to reduce yard waste. Again, I firmly believe that education is continuous. And so we just trying to keep hitting it home on social media and making little tweaks here and there to help educate our residents and our customers in hopes of curbing and reducing that contamination. And that's it for me.
Thank you, Kara. It's very interesting to hear how you've been able to really emphasize education around the contamination. Now, I know that a lot of, if there's other facilities on this site that do yard waste collection, not everybody is fortunate enough to have the carts to be able to kind of control and manage. So each way, whether or not you have it, you know, at your curbside and you're using a leaf bag or you're using carts, so they each have their own challenges, of course. But it was interesting to hear your perspective and the good work you're doing to try to educate your residents. We will keep this moving along. So I will move on to our next presenters. I'm going to actually introduce two presenters at the same time because they're kind of in their public-private partnership. So we have Carol Johnson with the Town of Zionsville, and we have Heather Mayberry with Earth Mama Compost. They were able to partnership together to offer some curbside organics collection within the city of Zionsville. So I let you guys take it away.
Thanks. Deanna, are you going to run my slides or do you need me to share screen?
It would be probably easiest if you can share screen unless you want me to. Obviously, I've been having some technical difficulties today.
I'll see what I can do. Heather, if you wouldn't mind just fill in the void for a minute, I'll try to get it pulled up.
Okay. I'll go ahead and go into a few things. What we've experienced since we started working with Zionsville, and a little bit about our program of giving back. So since we've started working with Zionsville, we've seen quite a bit of growth. We've gone from about 300 clients to 800 clients total. A third of those clients are in Zionsville. Carol's going to mention the weights that we've collected and how we've kind of made a big difference with that. And so a few things have happened. When we started our agreement with Zionsville, we had two clients in the area, maybe three. And within the first year, we bumped that up to 247 clients in Zionsville. And our growth is, I think we're at 278 clients there right now. So it's kind of stalled on the growth. But the good news is that we get zero contamination from any of our clients, which is lovely. And if people start composting with this, they just stay. If they make it past 2 months of composting, it means they love it and they stay forever, which is lovely. One thing that we do to give back and say thank you is we give a little bit of compost back to our clients. So we have a pile where they can come and grab some. And we do that for a couple of different reasons. The first is just to express our gratitude. But the second is because, Earth Mama seems to be focusing only on reducing our greenhouse gases by diverting our food waste from the landfill. But by giving back, we are hoping that we're sharing a small amount of compost, we're like planting a seed, because when we use that compost on the soil, it's helping to sequester carbon by increasing the health of the soil. It makes the soil more resilient to drought and flooding. And if our clients see, that their plants are healthier and more drought tolerant, they'll actually see there's less weeds as well. We're hopeful that they'll use compost instead of using fertilizer. And so we can reduce the amount of fertilizer that's used while we're reducing the greenhouse gases. So,
Carol, can you guys see the presentation now? Awesome. So thanks for that intro, Heather. I really appreciate it. And I had no idea you only started with two or three clients. I think that's amazing.
Yeah.
So we really couched our participation in opt-in residential curbside compost as one of our strategies in our climate action plan. So on the screen, you can see kind of the four main categories, and I underlined the one that this is part of, which is additional ways to divert waste. And it's a huge part of it because food waste is quite a bit of weight in every home's trash every week. So this is something we were able to do. We have a memorandum of understanding, and here's just some of the key points in it. They're always very formal, whereas, therefore. We used an estimating tool that about a quarter of everyone's trash was actually food waste. And so we were kind of doing our best guess in our MOU for how many pounds of food waste we would find every year. We're close to that amount. We're not quite there yet. I think we'll get there, especially when Heather adds in the pumpkins that they collect every year in Zionsville. It's amazing. And so this is kind of the therefore part of it. And one of the things that benefits Zionsville as a government is that there's really no cost to the government to do this, and there's no mandatory participation from our residents. Like Heather said, it's opt-in. As part of the MOU, Earth Mama Compost reduces the fees by half, and part of that is economies of scale, I suspect. So you get 200 people in one area instead of two people in one area. And so residents go straight to Earth Mama, they stay there in Zionsville, and they take it from there. And we do very little as far as hands-on. We'll promote it on our social media, we'll put out little flyers. And then this is one of we had a graphic designer do a quick design for us, kind of the basics of composting. And here's our stats that Heather and Matt have given us from Earth Mama Compost. It's, you can see the growth. I think it's interesting that once a household signs up, they stay. I am personally one of those households. And I could tell you immediately when we started putting our buckets out, the kids who are in charge of taking the trash to the curb said, "Why is there only one bag? It's really light this week. Where's all our trash?" I'm like, "It's in that bucket," because it's a substantial amount of waste. And then we used a civic workbook, which IU has online, if you wanted to look up how we calculated the metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent diverted. So this is kind of what we've done. And I don't know if Heather, if you have anything else you want to add, but I, as an employee and as a citizen, love this program. It's so easy to promote. It's so easy to talk about. It makes a dramatic difference in your week to week trash that you put out too. The pumpkins are crazy. Heather, do you want to talk about how many pumpkins you guys pick up?
Oh, good Lord. I think the first year Matt said we had 7,000 pounds of pumpkins. And then last year might have been 12,000. It was insane. And the 12,000, I think, was across all of our clients. So 7,000 just in Zionsville and 12,000 across all of our clients. That's what it was. So.
Great. Thanks to both of you. Heather, real quick, I know that on that flyer, it says that you take food waste and more. What are some of the more that you take from curbside?
So we take compostable plates that are compostable wares that are paper-like. So paper straws, unbleached napkins, unbleached paper towels on occasion. It has to all be mixed in with food waste.
I think pet hair too. We don't have any pets, but I think if you're brushing a long-haired dog or nail clippings.
Yes. We do have some additional questions, but we will move on to the next presenter and save that for the Q&A panel. So our next presenter we have is speaking a little bit about their very well-managed compost sites and their partnerships with the other cities to also help them manage their compost sites, as well as some other partnerships and outreach and expansion of their services. So I have Carrie Mars-Barron, Executive Director of the Porter County Recycling District. So she's a county level and that can then assist as well in the city level as well. So Carrie, you have the floor.
Thanks, Deanna. I'm going to send you, let's see if you guys can see my screen. Hopefully. Yeah, there you go. Wait for it. There you go. Bright and green.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. First off, my name is Carrie Mars-Barron. I am the director of the Recycling District. So for a few of you who are on the call, we are the Solid Waste District of Porter County. We just chose to change our name many years ago. I love the part just a few minutes ago where Kara discussed this is about education. So the Solid Waste District, we're a little bit in the middle of everyone. So we are always literally in the middle. So our mission is about improving the environment, quality of life, and we do that through educational programs that help residents reduce, reuse, and recycle. So hopping into compost sites, Porter County, we have 5 compost sites that we actually manage. So let me back that up. So I love these programs. I kept asking Deanna, this is crazy. Okay, I can talk about this, but now I follow the flow that it started from pilot programs to much bigger. So the site that you see right here, that is our Valparaiso compost site. At this point in time, it is one of our largest sites. And when I say our largest sites, the district does not own the site. We have memorandum of working agreements where we manage their sites. So there are 3 sites that have public access. So what that means is that the residents can bring their leaves, their brush and grass and their yard waste in. And then there are 2 municipal restricted sites in Porter County. That's in Chesterton and the Pines. And what that just means is it's strictly owned by the city and the community, and they just bring in their residents. So if they have curbside pickup, they bring it in, it is gated. There is no, residents are not permitted back into that site. So in the upper right corner, you'll see, this is just a screenshot of what a rough drawing of what Porter County looks like. And the 5 red marks or the words that are on there give you an idea of how the compost sites are spread throughout the county. So when we talk about what we do and what we manage what comes in. So leaves are dropped off. And when they are dropped off, they are dropped off into windrows. So if you can see on your screen, you can see the long rows in the community. So again, this is back at the Valparaiso site. The Valparaiso site's about 25 acres. And these rows come in from the Valpo trucks. I'm going to jump back a screen. If you see right there is a red truck that was being delivered, and it was bringing in the windrows, or bringing in the leaves for the windrows. We actually have a very neat process how this is done. I know we have a limited time at the very end of my presentation. I have 2 videos you are invited to watch, and they max out at 7 minutes. One, I think, is 3.5. The other is 4.5 minutes. And what it's doing is it's showing you our different processes. If you look at this, the windrows, you're going to see they look kind of lumpy. They're long rows, and at the end, they're grass. So in this specific, we only collect for our compost cycle, we only accept in these rows leaves, and our staff will place the grass on the leaves so that they are properly turned in and that there is a proper carbon nitrogen ratio. Our cycle for compost is 18 months. So before the questions come in about logs and woods and sticks and brush, that's a whole different collection, and I actually will talk on that in just a minute. So what happens is these leaves that come in, they come in the fall season. So about October, November, this area is wiped down to the ground. That's called reclaimed. So it starts out fresh. The leaves sit, and they will sit over the winter. They are turned, and a turner is a large piece of equipment that literally just pulls it through the bottom of the row one time. And in essence, it flips everything from the bottom to the top. Once it does that, it sets over the winter, it sets for a few more months, and then we try throughout the months of April to October, once a month, to go through each of those 5 sites and turn those rows. When that about 12 month happens and the new leaves are getting ready to come on, it's called a reclamation, and it's literally pulled over into a giant pot. Again, if you look at this picture all the way towards the back, you can almost see it looks like a large pile of black gold sitting in the back. That is the start of the compost. So there are fancy terms of technology. I joke about it, and my joke is that this is now, it's been there about 12 months, about October, November of the year, but it needs to sit to the following spring. This, my joke is, it's like a pot of chili. It tastes great the first day, but it tastes so much better the second day. This is how compost is the same way. If it sits over those winter months, all the pHs, all of the different leaves, the windrows and leaves that were in those rows continue to decompose even further. So it is great. It turns into amazing black gold, as it's commonly referred to in our area. to give you an idea of, I'll just jump in one more. I forgot about the windrow. So there is the machine that actually turns. There's a video that shows you exactly how it looks. It's just a one row pass. A tractor is pulling it through. And there is our amazing black gold. So just to give you a rough estimate of, you were talking about some pilot programs. Last year, I just looked up our numbers. Between the three public sites, we had 35,000 visitors come to Porter County. 35,000 visitors came to the sites, and about 100,000 cubic yards of all yard waste was collected between these sites. So what happens with the logs and the brush? These are the logs and the brush that are collected. And we actually bring in a contractor who grinds them. This is a very large tub grinder. And what happens to that material is it is, you know, it looks like a brush pile. It is finely ground up and it turns into mulch. So a couple other things why our partnerships really work here with the different communities is because we also offer a lot of different services at these sites. We also can drop off household batteries, electronics, televisions, fluorescent light bulbs, toter cartridges, smoke detectors, plastic bag collections, household recyclables, and even books. So this is why we receive so many visitors to the site, because there's so many different things that people can bring. But that number of just about 35,000 is strictly for yard waste. But what I'm also excited about is we just are unveiling. So we are literally just unveiling a food waste composting pilot program that should be kicking off in about, within the next month. I guess I could say Friday. So we're hoping to kick it off in fall. And in fall, we are looking so forward to 20 families, 20 homes are going to start. It sounds like it's very similar to Zionsville, that they started with a bucket program. We have a private landowner who is willing to, till we figure out our program and the glitches and the things we need to improve before we can grow it and make it into more of a curbside municipal program. But right now, what it is we've asked residents to fill out an application, collect their waste, collect lots of data. That's what we're hearing from many pilot programs. There's never enough data. We have a driver who's going to pick up their buckets and drop the food waste off. And we'll do this to collect as much food waste as we can. I totally agree with the other presenters. Food waste is one of the largest programs that we need to get out of the landfill. So it is a lot of greenhouse gas contributor as well. So there is lots of information I could share. I'd like to just include a couple quick things, and I know we had a quick delay, but the district, we are here to help anyone who wants to do composting. If you are interested in yard waste composting, we work with IDEM. We have great reviews. Our program's been in place very well efficient for a good 15 years, I'm guessing, way before I started. But we take calls all the time from different municipalities, park departments on how you get it started. So at the very end of the slide, you're going to find my email. You're going to find our generic info at Porter County Recycling. I have the best staff. They will certainly take care of all of this. Yeah. So
there are five different concepts.
Here's a couple thing of our videos. I think it's and fun due to such a short time, I want to let you know that we have a drive-through, we call it. It's about a three-minute video. The drive-through video just walks you through. We have a guard shack, so when you pull up, you walk through, you drive through, somebody will greet you, ask you a quick question, where are you going? They'll direct you where to go, because of course, we wanna make sure that people are in the right spot and the things are happening that are being properly dropped off. And then certainly not last is the windrow turning video, who is our operator, Steve, who is a phenomenal compost operator. And we have a great site, we have many great sites because of all of the things that he does as well. So highly encourage you to watch those videos. If they both should be on YouTube, if they don't appear, please send information my way. So if you have any questions, feel free to holler and pop back and let me know. I tried to condense that really quickly to keep us on a timeline too. So Deanna knows this is a much greater operation, but I'm just trying to do a quick overview. So
thanks, Carrie. That was a fantastic overview. And as Carrie mentioned, she thought they might be in operations for 15 years. And to somewhat age myself and to mention it, I was a staff member at the district 15 years ago. And so it had already been in operations probably 10 plus years before that. So it is a long running, long standing program. And I'm happy that you're able to share the work that you guys are doing. So.
I take this with great pride every time I fill out the renewal. We're 6401 for Valpo. So we are the Valparaiso site is the first compost site in Porter County. So
so we've kind of gone on a little bit of a journey so far through the collection process, through a little bit of different avenues and materials that we can take and different ways that material is accepted. And we've also looked at the compost sites themselves and how they can be managed effectively. Carrie, I might have a question for you in the Q&A panel about your contamination results and how you deal with that, since we did talk about that at the beginning. But we'll save that so that we have time for our next presenter. And just to let everybody know, I will go ahead and get those links to the videos from Carrie, and I will share that in an email to all the participants after the session is over, so that you'll have that as well as contact information. So our next presenter is offering kind of another organics management perspective. Composting is not exactly the only answer, right? In our waste management hierarchy, they also provide anaerobic digestion as a way to manage organics waste. So I've asked Haley Griffey from the City of West Lafayette to talk about how they have promoted and created a program of food waste collection and organics that incorporates their anaerobic digester at their wastewater treatment plant.
Great, thanks, Diana. I'm also going to stick with the theme and share my screen. All right, please let me know if you can see that PowerPoint.
Yes, I can see it.
Yeah, we can see it.
Awesome. Thank you. So as Diana mentioned, I'll be talking about organics management through anaerobic digestion here at the City of West Lafayette. And also, just in case you didn't catch it, my name is Haley Griffey. I am the Climate Resiliency Sustainability Officer for the city. Just wanted to give a bit of background about the West Lafayette Food Waste Program, also better known as Waste Watts. So this quote was taken directly from the EPA. It states that the green power of West Lafayette comes from an innovative waste to energy treatment system that co-digests fats, oils, and grease, also known by the acronym FOG, food scraps and sludge, also known as biosolids, and anaerobic digesters, and then uses the biogas generated to power microturbines at the plant. So this is a very relatively long program. Starting in 2009, this is when the city, as well as Purdue University, began collaboration to actually implement these programs, trying to divert food waste from the university dining halls to our anaerobic digester. Moving forward a decade later, in 2019, the program expanded in partnership with the Purdue Student Sustainability Council, as well as our City Go Greener Commission. And here at the Water Resource Recovery Facility, we expanded our food waste collection system to include 4 Purdue University Greek houses, as well as a food waste drop-off location for West Lafayette residences. Although these are the 2 main expansions we've had of the program, there have been some additions here and there, as well as some new technology introduced that I'll mention throughout the presentation today. Going into the setup for this quick presentation, first I would like to talk about the foundation of education and outreach for the Waste to Watts program, as well as our food waste collection methods, the process of anaerobic digestion, and then overall our diversion and mitigation results. So as you can see at the bottom, I do want to mention the partners in this program. I think we take a lot of pride in collaboration on reducing our food waste throughout the West Lafayette community. So of course, we have the City of West Lafayette, Purdue University, University, as well as our City Go Greener Commission, the Purdue Student Sustainability Council, Purdue Environmental and Ecological Engineering Department, as well as Engage Purdue. So moving forward into education and outreach, it's very audience oriented. So overall, the Waste Watts program is divided into two components, and that's Purdue University as well as the greater West Lafayette community. So speaking with the latter of West Lafayette residents of all ages, we do have green toters that we purchase and give out for free. You can see one on your screen. I also have one right here, so you can see relative size. They're not too big. They're known as our countertop recycling bins. And on them, you'll see that there is a sticker just to help with education. It's showing what is acceptable and what is not acceptable. So overall, what is acceptable are unpackaged and degradable food products, including fruits, meat, dairy, bread, vegetables, and processed food. Also, especially for businesses that are willing to participate and drop things off occasionally, we do allow FOG, which are fats, oils, and grease, to be accepted and collected at our anaerobic digester. So some of our community outreach events that we do happen at the West Lafayette Farmers Market, where some of our Go Greener commissions do activities with youth and at the same time educate them and their guardians on what is accepted and what isn't accepted and how they can get involved with food waste programs. We also do tabling at local community events as well to hand out the similar information. In terms of the Purdue campus side of things, you can see in the bottom right-hand corner, one of our Go Greener commissioners, who's a student at Purdue, actually hosted a trivia night recently this past academic year to engage Purdue students and let them know a little bit more about food waste, where your food goes if you throw it in the trash, why you should try not to throw it in the trash, and also where it goes when it's sent to dining halls on campus. So more specifically regarding food waste collection and those locations, at Purdue University, there are a few pickup locations. So at Purdue, they are not required to bring their food waste to us at the Water Resource Recovery Facility. Instead, we go and we pick it up with our Streets and Sanitation Department equipment. So some of our pickup locations on campus are at dining halls and food courts, as well as Greek Life Houses. Each year since we've invited Greek Life Houses to participate in 2019, they've ranged from 4 all the way up to 10 houses, and some stay year to year. Some are only on for a year if they have a certain sustainability coordinator who's really passionate about this work. But overall, we have a good 7 to 8 regular houses now. In terms of the community and where they can bring their food waste, we do have a community drop-off location. So they'll able to bring their food waste as well as fats, oils, and grease over to the West Lafayette Street and Sanitation Department. As you can see in that bottom right-hand corner, this is one of our food waste drop-off bins. So again, it has a sign attached that tells exactly what is and what isn't accepted, as well as more information on the program. And I also grabbed a snippet from a local news video from 2021 when we got our new food waste collection bin to put on one of our street and sanitation trucks. This was actually an IDEM Recycling Market Development Program grant. So I wanted to include this in there as well to show how our technology is still changing from year to year, even though this program is over a decade old. And overall, our collection totals for the past few years are up in the corner. Currently in 2023, as of late July, we had about 6.36 tons, which has been on track since COVID around the year 2020, and we had noticeably lower tonnage. And overall at the bottom, you can see to date, we've had over 4.6 million pounds of food waste that we've diverted and converted into energy at the wastewater recovery facility. So moving into the anaerobic digestion process, I didn't want to get too technical because I know there are a lot of resources online, but just a basic overview. At the top, you have food waste. Whenever I mention food waste, please also consider FOG as well, fats, oils, grease. Those are brought either from Purdue residences, from the Greek houses, or from dining halls and food courts over directly to the Water Resource Recovery Facility. And we also bring them over from the food drop-off bins at the Street and Sanitation Department, using those new bins we got for our trucks. So when food waste is dropped off, as you can see on the right-hand side, it's put into our anaerobic digester. Once it enters our anaerobic digester, microorganisms do break down the organic material and they produce biogas as well as digestate. So our biogas is used in the combined heat and power process to power a generator, which is overall used to produce electricity for the plant. In terms of our Digest 8 has two components. So there's a liquid and a solid component. In terms of mainly the solid component, this can be used as fertilizer on local farms and gardens, just to keep it where it needs to be and keep the process going in somewhat of a circular economy as much as possible. Moving forward then into the overall results, which are diversion and mitigation. This is what we like to focus on when educating about the program, as well as tracking. So for diversion, of course, we're diverting food waste from entering landfills and also reducing tipping fees for the university and our local recycling and solid waste district. In terms of mitigation, mitigating carbon emissions, not only produced by the water resource recovery facility, but also methane emissions from local landfills where the food would be sent if it wasn't digested. And it also helps to reduce our utility energy costs. Specifically, the biogas produced and the electricity resulting provides approximately 20% of our energy needs at the West Lafayette Water Resource Recovery Facility, which is approximately 265 kilowatt microturbines. And also, to promote education on this program and tie it into our community goals, we always like to bring it back to our recently adopted Greater Lafayette Climate Action Plan. So our goals for the plan are throughout Greater Lafayette to reduce our carbon emissions 58% by 2030. And not only that, we do have a few specific goals focused on enhancing recycling, waste reduction, and composting. And this program allows us to meet those goals and help reduce our carbon emissions. Overall, this program is holistic throughout West Lafayette. It helps us to divert food waste from landfills to reduce our overall carbon emissions as a city, as well as increase awareness and education about food waste and actually have people question where their food goes when they throw it away. And then last but not least, help to advance our community goals. With that, that's the end of my presentation. If you have any additional questions or comments that might not be answered by this meeting, please don't hesitate to reach out. My email and my phone number are below, and I'd invite any calls. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Haley. Mm-hmm. We had some wonderful presentations from all of our presenters today, and a lot of information, and just kind of seeing some of the comments and thinking of and reflecting on what I've heard already. Indiana, even though we are not known as being so, you know, forward when it comes to composting, recycling, all those things, this is just a small little snippet of the programs we have going on in Indiana. I know that the universities, not only West Lafayette, but here in Indianapolis and other places, have some really wonderful compost programs, food waste programs that I would have loved to have highlighted. Other cities and towns, of course, our solid waste management districts, even some other private compost sites. It's really a collective effort, and I think that we should be proud in the way what we've done so far, and just hopefully we're able to support that further. Some of you guys mentioned being able to do some of your efforts through items, recycling grants. So I did want to bring those up. There are two grant opportunities. There's the community recycling grants, and our community recycling grant coordinator did share in the chat the link for those as they are open right now. Those are great for communities and smaller grants from $1,000 to $100,000 with a 25% cash match. Then for bigger pieces of equipment and larger projects, we have the recycling market development grants that are also open to municipalities, businesses, towns, nonprofits, just not schools and universities. That one has a bigger up to $500,000 and a 50% cash match. And that's usually open and available for applications in the spring. And this is our fall program. So we're always excited to get those proposals and applications in, and we try to fund as many of those as we can. So let's go ahead and maybe hit some of the questions that were sent through the chat. And if you have any other questions for our presenters, please go ahead and also enter those into the chat. I know there was one up here from Heather. it says, Heather, you had zero contamination for your pickups, which is a fabulous story to tell. So they had a question about, is there any particular method or strategy that you have to produce those kinds of results? And you're still on mute, Heather.
Okay, so the 0% contamination is for my residential clients. We found that if people are participating, it's because they're passionate, and so they're going to be very careful not to contaminate. As far as the commercial clients, we're very picky about who we allow to compost with us. And if we have ongoing issues with contamination, then we start by education and then eventually have to discontinue people. As far as our commercial clients, I think we had one bag of it was contaminated from a preschool, and they've been with us for probably 10 years. So they contaminate like maybe twice a year. We really don't have a lot of contamination because we're so picky. But one thing that we do is we only use 5-gallon buckets. I know a lot of programs use the 32-gallon bins for the larger facilities. But we just started composting for 17 cafeterias for the Carmel schools. And some of our clients have 20 or 30 buckets, but because we're using a smaller container that does not look like a trash can, it changes that mindset of putting the food waste in. And we also use a poster with just very easy pictures of what foods we allow for our commercial kitchens, and we really slim down what we'll take for commercial programs.
Thank you, Heather. I see the next question we have asks, how can a municipality that has a yard waste program already in place start to accept food waste at the site? I don't have the full answer to that one. Besides that, usually it requires a change to your compost registration if you're a registered compost site with ITEM. So you would reach out to our ITEM staff. And if you need help getting in contact with the correct ITEM staff, then I just reach out to me and I will get you connected as far as that's concerned. But yeah, it's a change to the compost registration permits. And there's some additional requirements and restrictions to making sure like there's no vector contamination and other things to be allow you to start accepting food waste as well. I don't know, Carrie, if you have any other thoughts on that.
Interesting. I actually just spoke to Lake County last week for the fact that Lake County does have the IDEM permit with for food waste, and that's exactly what you said. They had to have a special area of their site, the way it's monitored, and just the forms and the context you have to have. So,
and so I see this was answered in the chat, but someone did ask about the Porta County's food waste compost pilot, if that was being funded through the district, the equipment, the operators. So Carrie did mention that it's a very small pilot for only 20 residents, and they are currently able to fund that. I know there was at least one more question I saw. Carrie, you asked to Heather if there's a fee to be part of the program. Is that for Earth Mama Compost to pick up the food waste? Yeah, so Heather, you can talk on that. I know there is a charge, yes.
Yeah, our typical charge is $20 a month. With Zionsville, we've given them a 50% discount for the residents, and so that's only $10 a month. We stop by every other week, And our clients are able to put out a second 5-gallon container at no additional cost if they create too much food waste for just the one 5-gallon container.
So those are all the questions that I see currently in our chat window. If you guys think anybody participating today ever have anything they think of, they can always reach out to us and I can try to reach out to the presenters. I want to thank the presenters again for taking the time. And I want to thank everybody on this call for your patience and transitioning from Zoom to Teams and then the technical difficulties in getting that Teams up and running at the start of the meeting. Thank you for hanging in there and participating still with us today.
Deanna?
Yes.
Did you see my one question? Sorry, it came through really quickly in the end. I'm just curious how many large-scale operations there are, commercial operations that can take it. Obviously, county operations are a little bit different because they cannot take all of the materials from outside, you know, the counties.
Right. Okay. I have to go back to my slides, actually, and my facts. So you're asking how many, like, registered compost sites in Indiana take food waste? You said commercial. Now, I don't have that answer offhand, commercial versus municipal.
Well, I guess it could be municipal if they take outside of their community. I mean, you know, but most municipal doesn't take outside of their community.
Right. Right. So that's a very good point. And I don't have an answer to that. I don't think that any of our required reporting for compost sites requires them to say what geography that they accept their food waste from. We do have 16 total compost sites that are registered and actively reporting numbers to us on their food waste. I know of maybe one or two offhand just from grants and talking to people that are private compost operations that will take it from the communities. So
that's the two I probably know too. I was right. Just hoping that maybe, you know, again, we're sitting here talking about this. A lot of people would like to participate. I certainly know a lot of people in Johnson County would like to participate. You know, it's awesome what Zionsville is doing, but it's so hard because there are more Zionsvilles than just Zionsville, you know, that would like to do the same thing. So how do we get that going in the state?
Yeah, and that's a great question. And I think, you know, education, these talks where we talk about the need for it, and hopefully we connect with people who see the need for it and want to start a commercial operation like this, being able to help provide a little bit of grant funding for that startup cost. It's a challenge. And there's challenges around operating those. I know like one site has had to scale down their operations.
Hey, Deanna.
Yeah.
Can I jump in? I'm going to jump in because I've been exploring food waste since 2020, since the pandemic hit us, because it became my fascination. And two of the challenges Porter County looked at was years ago, IDEM used to, and I've been told they don't anymore, but for instance, like our local Walmart wanted to drop off when we looked into food waste many years ago, like the old lettuce, and it was considered industrial waste because it was coming from a commercial site. So even though Walmart, your grocery store, so when the residents heard that industrial waste was coming into their community, everybody's arms literally were thrown up in the air. And so there was a lot of hurdles. So that was step one. Step two, the second hurdle we faced was equipment. We run a very successful yard waste project, and we were told, you know, you need different equipment. Your equipment, if it goes to the yard waste, it has to be clean, sanitized before it can go into food waste. So those were two crazy hurdles I know as a community we've, you know, obviously encountered as well. So getting through the hurdles, but that's just something that we've been facing.
Thanks, Carrie. Yeah, I am also posting a link to our item website to a Excel sheet. Item does post a list of the registered compost facilities and annual report on their website. I think someone asked about it. You can also probably go to the item website to better. Let me. Additional information. So before we leave, it is 3:30. I do want to take a quick moment. I'm going to actually do a quick poll, and I wanted to bring up this idea, and it will be in the evaluation form as well. But there has sort of been a gap recently in a conference that we can bring interesting recycling, waste management, materials management stakeholders together in the state to connect, discuss issues, learn new trends. And so I am going to post a poll really quick and trying to get kind of everybody's interest on whether they would be interested in item sort of kind of helping to host a state conference in the next year in 2024. I have to figure out. There we go. I'm launching it. And so one, you're not interested in attending something like this. Number five, you're very interested in attending. Hopefully this has popped up in your meeting and you are able to select one option and submit it to me. This just gives us an idea if we should be pursuing something along these lines. We've been able to, you know, have these quarterly meetings. And I think that's helped along the lines, but maybe a one day conference where we're all brought together and able to meet and network in person kind of sounds like something that I'd be interested in. And I was just kind of wanting to explore what everybody else is interested in. There's additional questions regarding this conference on the evaluation form. So I really appreciate everybody taking their time to go to that link. I will also send it as a follow-up email. And filling out that evaluation form and letting me know of your interest in participating, even helping planning and organizing or providing some sponsorship opportunities as well. So we got 73% of those voted said yes, very interested. So that's exciting. One more comment from our Deputy Assistant Commissioner. And this is a great point too. We are relaunching our Clean Community Program for municipal government participation. Things like recycling and composting will be components of becoming a clean community and getting that kind of recognition. So definitely look into follow that link if you're interested in that for those municipalities on the call today. We are 3 minutes over. So thank you guys. All the presenters, you guys really hang in there and tightened your presentations, and we somehow managed to get it all fit in the time allowed. So really appreciate all of you today, rest of your day, and hopefully we'll see you on the next call. Thanks guys. Bye.